the idea of today's talk is to give you a quick whistle through the important things in the history of Irish Gaelic harps that we talk about, just to make sure that you're a little bit familiar with the people and the harps and the whole historical things. We talk about the Trinity harp or the Downhill harp or even Bunting or whatever. You know what the deal is and what's going on. So this handout is a little useful thing for you to slip into your folder, okay? And so on the front is a list of all the old museum harps that we rattle on about. So you can see every single one, and they're approximately to scale. So you can see from the little list at the top, the Trinity and the Queen Mary, down to the big monsters at the bottom, like Rose Mooney. Just to give you a little overview of the tradition. And then if you turn over on the back, this is old pictures of harps and harpers. And so again, this is interesting. You should kind of know about all these and know who they are and where they are and what they look like. So if somebody talks about the Jerpoint Abbey carving, you can go, oh yes, it's that thing. Do you see what I mean?
Yeah.
So it's kind of nice to know this stuff. It's nice to get a visual memory of them and to get used to what's going on. Did you get one of these?
Yes, you did.
So put this in a folder and use it as ready reference. So and my title screen is just a fun picture of Jane Carter up in Longwood in Trinity College with her copy of Trinity College harp beside the real thing, just for a bit of fun, because it's always good to see the real and the imitation side by side like that. So the first thing that I like to talk about, because people talk about the early Irish harp and the old Irish harp traditions, and sometimes this can be a bit misleading, a bit of a misnamed thing, because we're really not talking about an Irish thing, we're talking about a Gaelic or Gaelic thing. Okay, these traditions, the song traditions and the harp traditions and the language traditions that we're all talking about and working on are part of a wider old Gaelic world. And it basically covers the whole of Ireland, it's the Isle of Man, and it covers this half of Scotland. Okay? I mean, there's more or less, so Ireland is fairly coherent, Scotland is more fragmented because you have all different cultural things. You have the kind of Anglo-cultural world coming this way, and you have the Scandinavian cultural world coming down this way. So in Scotland, perhaps it's more multicultural than in Ireland, but still, there's a useful concept of the old Gaelic world. And you can see that here, on the space in between the north of Ireland and the southwest of Scotland, it's a very small distance. If you're a harper up here, it's much easier to get to gigs here than it is to get to gigs here. Yeah? So this is like the kind of, before the roads were built, this is the Heathrow Airport of the old Gaelic world. This is where everything was happening. So Dennis O'Hampsey was from here. Patrick Quinn was from this area. The Sky is where Rory Dow Morrison was working. South Argyle is where there's harpers. Iona is where the Queen Mary harp decoration puts its prominence. So you can see it's this part of the world is a kind of hotbed of some aspects of the harp tradition. We're here, by the way, in Kilkenny. Right. So I like you to keep in mind this map, this kind of cognitive space of where we are in the world, how Kilkenny fits into the old Gaelic world, and how places and people that are mentioned in our studies fit into the space. Okay. Oh, I knew I'd forget something. You need 3D goggles for this one.
Yay.
I knew I'd forget.
Because the pictures from Scotland are always the funniest, and they have people in 3D goggles.
I hope there's enough for one each. Big podcast on. Anybody with only one eye, you can pass yours to a friend.
Yours away.
I
need.
No,
we
can swap my chair.
Well, pass it on. If you have one eye,
you
can see.
I give it to you. Say,
pass it on.
Wow, I see something.
Does it work?
Yes, it does.
So these are the earliest harp objects from Ireland to Scotland. This is actually from the east of Scotland, but there are similar ones from Ireland. And you can see the trouble with this from a music history point of view is that all you get is King David sitting on the throne with a triangle and a stripy thing in front of him. You can't really tell much about it. You can't tell how many strings it's got, how they're tuned. Does he have an accordion on his harp? What kind of intonation does he use? What's his pitch standard?
Are his strings stone?
What do his, yes, a stone strung harp. So it's interesting because it gives us the idea of triangular string instruments. This is about 8th or 9th century, I think, so about 1200 years ago.
I thought we looked at it as he started playing or something. Why is this on the top? Is that standard harp?
It's a chair. Well, actually, there's an interesting side. There's an interesting sideline about this. Is that there was a scholar called Helen Rowe. She did a study of King David playing the stringed instrument as an iconographic thing. And as you go back in time, the head gets bigger, the feet become more claw-like, and the stringed instrument shrinks and becomes more oval. And you end up at the very beginning with Orpheus playing the lyre riding on the back of a leopard. And there's a continuity from classical depiction of Orpheus riding the leopard all the way through to King David sitting on his throne. I think it's Orpheus, don't quote me on that. It might be somebody else. You should pick up Helen Rowe's article, it's good fun. Here's another one for you. This one's also 3D, so put your specs on. This is the stone cross at Monas Pois, which is north of Dublin. And I hope you can see he's got a triangular thing in front of him as he's playing. I should have shown you the bigger picture, because this is Christ in majesty in the centre, and on his right hand are the elect. They're all the people here who are the saved souls, and there is a man playing pipes and a man playing the
pipes for all the saved.
No, so this is a trumpet. This is a trumpet, not a pipe. But then on his left hand is the piper. The damned. So the half of the trumpet are with the elect, and the pipes are with the damned. So very fair, sensible, and reasonable. Anyway, you can put your specs away now, because that's the only 3D pictures I've got for this talk. This is the famous shrine of St. Mauve, and this is about 1,000 years ago, and so you can see there's more detail, but you still can't tell how many strings he's got, where the accordion is, any of that stuff. You can see he's got the fish on the front pillar, which is cool. Very interesting to see that, but you still can't see exactly how big this harp is, exactly how it works, in the kind of technical and logical sense. So you can see that there are harps there, you can see things about it, but you can't really do much with it. Okay? There's a kind of gap in high medieval times, but when you get to the 14th, 15th century, you get these stone carvings from the west of Scotland, the Hebrides, that area that I was talking about last night, the Lauriston Isles. The islands between Scotland and Ireland. And this is two grave stacks. The one on the left is the one that there was a picture of on your program sources class. We looked at that image. In fact, we looked at both these images for evidence of having some of their hearts. So this guy's kind of sitting, maybe with his legs crossed, or maybe on a little stool. And this guy's kneeling down with his feet tucked underneath him. So you get ideas about performance practice. You get ideas about context from looking at the people and the things depicted on these monuments. We still don't have technical information about the harp. How big was it? How many strings? Did it have an accordion? Where were they pitched? What are the string lengths? What's the spacing like? How wide is the soundbox between the knees? All these questions are really important for a performing musician. Luckily for us, the answer to that is these two things, which are going off the edge of the screen in an embarrassing way. And,
Fortunately, it's just creeping onto the roll-up banner.
No, it's
banner.
Not. It's my slide.
Well, I mean your heart.
Yeah. Oh yeah, you can continue this. You should have lined the projector up better.
Sorry.
So these are late medieval, genuine surviving musical instruments. And this is where it all kicks off, because these are the actual musical instruments that were played by musicians in the old tradition. So you can look at them, you can measure them, you can touch them if you smile at them. No, you can't touch them because some people are handsy. But you can commission a replica. And so that's what my harp is that you all saw last night. I commissioned this from a sculptor as an exact museum wouldn't let me touch the real thing, so I have to have my own. So I, but I want mine to be as exact as possible as the real thing. So no compromise, no changes, to make it work as a kind of archaeological tool to understand the old parts. And so to me, this is like the high point of the medieval Gallic art tradition. This is when the tradition is flourishing at its height, at its most classical form. This is the Gallic half equivalent of Stradivarius violins. You know, this is when the true masters were working on music, on instrument making. They knew what they were doing. They were embedded in a rich and vibrant Gallic culture of high arts and patronage and learning and culture and civilization. And these are the harps that they were made and played in that context. So from that point of view, these are really iconic and important. Disappearing off the side, that's such a shame. We can escape and
change your
well, that's exactly what I'm going to do. It's because I was plugged into the school system and it changes my displays. Where is it? Displays. You can edit this bit out of the video and we help. What should we try? That looks more like normal, doesn't it?
That's right.
Okay. Can you zoom in? So what happens is there's an interesting, after that high point, from some points of view, that's when it starts going downhill and the tradition starts to be in decline. Maura was mentioning this in the sources class. At what point do you say the tradition is at its height, and at what point do you say it's in decline? Because this is actually quite an interesting cultural trope in early Irish harp studies. There's a lot of looking back at the good old days. There's an interesting 17th century quote about, you know, about a patron trying to get a harp for himself, and his agent writes back saying, "Well, I tried to get an old antique harp for you because they say the old ones are far better, and I couldn't, so you have to put up with a new one." And so there's this constant thing that in the old days it was all much better. But I think from a certain point of view, you can say yes, the Queen Mary and the Trinity College harp, they are high points. And everything after that is starting to go downhill. And you could argue that for good cultural reasons, because there's the whole colonial thing, that Gallic culture is under attack, it is being suppressed by the Anglo-colonial project in Ireland and in Scotland. You could also argue that the tradition was just developing and going its own way, so I'm not going to make a judgment either way, but these are some of the cultural currents that you have to understand. So William Archdeacon is interesting, in about 1750, I think he's got quite an old style harp here. It could be a medieval harp, it could be a 16th century harp. It's closest in form to the Lamont harp, which is preserved in Scotland and has a completely Scottish provenance. It's said to have been from the west of Scotland, but for a lot of its life it was in the centre of Scotland. So it's a very interesting instrument. It's been studied in great detail by Karen Lucas, and we have her article about it and her thesis in the library, so you can read up about the Lamont harp and the Queen Mary harp. The portrait of William Archdeacon is very fun. You can see his hand shape, you can see how he's spreading his base hand and curling his left hand, you can see his left orientation. But his family as well, they're all looking and pointing in certain directions. And the most interesting is this lady here, who's holding in her hand a music sheet with notation on it. But the photographs they have of the painting are just a bit too fuzzy to read the notes. So, and the painting's in private ownership, and we can't have access to it. So it's, you can almost make out the tune as he's playing, but not quite. It's very frustrating. Over the time, the harps get bigger, and the musicians get grumpier. So this is Dennis O'Hampsley, who's very well known and famous. He was the last player to play with long fingernails in the end of the 18th century. And he was notable because he played with long fingernails. All the others, all his contemporaries, had cut their nails short to get a more up-to-date sound. So this is very interesting. His he is often held up as an icon of the old tradition because he was the last to play with nails. But the corollary of that is that he was a bit of an oddball. Nobody else was playing with nails. He was a bit of a kind of grumpy old eccentric. So that's a good question. His harp is preserved in Dublin, and we'll all see it on Tuesday in the Guinness Museum. And Anne was really sneaky and managed to get into Guinness and have a go at it a long time ago when they had even less tasteful carpet than they have there. So, Dennis Hampsey and the downhill harp. Here's Patrick Quinn and his Otway harp, which is also said to have been made by the same persons about the same time. The Otway harp is doing that thing, it's pretending to be older than it really is, I think. It claims to be built in 1707, but it's got the look of a 16th or 17th century instrument with its paintwork and its low-headed form. You would call the instruments that go up at the front high-headed and the ones that go down at the front low-headed, because it's a thing that some people call them. But he's very interesting. Quinn's interesting because he's the man who gives us all of the beginner's tunes, and he gives us an interesting repertory, and we have his harp, and so it's a great resource for studying the old music. After that generation died, about 1800, there were schools set up to preserve the tradition. But this is like a kind of, this is the first revival of the Irish harp. So a person like Patrick Byrne, he did learn in an unbroken lineage. So his master was Edward McBride, and Edward McBride's master was Arthur O'Neill, one of the old harpers. But he's not learning Arthur O'Neill in the context of a living indigenous Gaelic harp tradition. He's learning in a charitable school set up by Anglo elites to preserve the ancient national music as a deliberate political policy. So there's a whole question here about how much is Patrick Byrne a genuine tradition bearer and how much is he a kind of representative of an artificial last gasp attempt to keep it going. I tend to think fondly of him that he's a genuine tradition bearer, but there's no doubt that his technique and style and instrument have been updated a lot in the early to mid-19th century. And this is not his harp, this is just another example of these harps that the Harp Society had in the 1830s. By Egan. We might see one of those on Tuesday in the College Barracks, I'm not sure. Okay. And Patrick Byrne died, and that's it, there's no more Irish harpers. Okay. Except there was. Okay. There were harps in Ireland. The harp on the right is an Irish harp, made by John Egan in Dublin. It's just a double action pedal harp. Okay, so harps continue to be played in Ireland all the way through, but in a different tradition. And this is the thing that interests me a lot, is that it's the tradition, it's where you get the music and the ideas from that counts, not necessarily where it's made, where you're from, what the name is. It's where your inheritance is from, it's where you're getting your culture from. So Egan, as a pedal harp maker, was getting his culture from London, from Paris, from the classical tradition. He was making pedal harps. And Margaret MacLean Claffey on the left was a woman from the Isle of Mull in the Hebrides, and she was a Gaelic speaker and a scholar and a folklorist. She collected old Gaelic harp tunes that had been handed down in Mull family tradition from the last of the harpers in Scotland, and she played them on the harp, but she played them on pedal harp because that was her musical inheritance. Her musical training was from classical music on the pedal harp and piano. So this is like the first real attempt at reviving the tradition after the death the last tradition bearers. And we can laugh at her and say, oh, poor wee lass, doesn't she realise she's got the wrong instrument? But it's an interesting question. She's got a harp. Okay, we say it's the wrong kind of harp, but this is a fine judgment as to what's right and what's wrong. Should we be judging, you know? Of course you can judge, you can be discerning, but there are questions. Okay, so think about this. So in some ways she's in the same revival tradition that we are. She's looking back at the old tradition, trying to get it up and running with the resources that she has access to. Okay, Egan spotted a gap in the market, because people said right back then, well, no, the double action pedal harp is not the ancient Irish harp. The ancient Irish harp is small, it has a curved front. And Egan said, well, I can do that. And so he took his single double action pedal harps and shrunk them, chopped the bass off, and replaced the pedals with little finger levers, but it has the full single action harp mechanism inside. It's got strings and everything, and you can play it like a single action pedal harp. printed, manufactured, and sold by John Egan, double and single action pedal hat maker, 30 Dawson Street, Dublin. And that is the ancestor of all gutted nylon strung Celtic harps to the present day. Okay? A new invention in the early 19th century by Egan, marrying together the Anglo-continental tradition of the gut-strung pedal harp with the romantic idea of a small, curvy Irish harp covered in shamrocks. Okay, this man is very interesting. Owen Lloyd, he studied harp with the Welsh harpers in the 1850s or so. He played pedal harp, but you see he was in a left orientation because the Welsh harpers were still playing left side then. So he played left side. He was an Irish man. From. He got hold of one of the Egan Society harps. His first public performance in the 1860s, he shared a platform with some of the Society harpers who had learned from students of Arthur O'Neill. So I had a question here, did he talk to them? Did he learn stuff from them? Is he a missing link? I suspect he might not have been. I mean, you know, for all I know, he got the antique harp and strung a gut and played like a pedal harp. But it's also possible that he got that harp because he met the old guys, because he realised what they had, because he'd learned from them. I don't know yet. We need to find out more. But he's interesting. We need to find out more about him. In the 1890s, there was a big Gaelic revival in Scotland, and they had Gaelic singing at the Mods from 1891, I think, maybe 1892. And this is an 1892 photograph of one of the Gaelic singers with her reconstructed medieval Gaelic harp. This has metal strings. It's a museum copy of the harp's museum. Well, it's an approximate museum copy. And on the right is a photograph of one of these harps made by Glenn in Edinburgh in the 1890s. And the problem with these things is that if you have a training as a pedal harpist and you pick up one of these reproduction harps, it doesn't really work. And so within a year, they abandoned these and switched over to gut-strung harps like the ancestors of modern reed harps. It's very interesting. It was only about a year or so that they tried getting a medieval reed harp up and running, but just said, no, it doesn't work, we need something better. And they invented a new kind of gut-strung harp, very similar to the Egan portable harps. This harp belongs to the Harp Society, but it's not here. It's at Natalie's house in Connemara. James McFall in Belfast was making Irish harps from about 1900 right through to 1950. So we don't know what the date of this one is, but it has metal strings. So James McFall, most of his harps would have gut strings, but occasionally he made wire strung harps as an experiment. But I don't know of anybody who played these things. It doesn't really work very well. But people were aware that there was a tradition, an older tradition with wire strings with a different touch that he didn't know how to play. And here's Jimmy O'Brien Moran with a harp made by Henry, who was a folklore collector in the South of Ireland in County Cork about 100 years ago, and who seems to have made a copy of the Trinity College harp, which looks pretty good. I've never seen this harp, but I wonder if Henry played it or what the deal was. I don't know much about this. But there were people out there trying to get it up and running with not that much success. This is Edith Taylor. Now, nobody really has ever said much about Edith Taylor, and I've been chasing her for the last year because she had a Dolmetsch harp. Arnold Dolmetsch made wire strung harps copied after the Trinity College harp in about 1932. And I have one here. This is number 10 out of a series of 15 that he made at once. So this is 1932, this harp. And Edith Taylor had one of these. You can see how they're holding it. It's not this one, the wood grain is different. It has very thin metal wire strings, but she played left shoulder with her fingernails. She did concerts. She played at the Mod every year. She won the classic competition at the Mod quite a few years. She taught. She lived for a while out in the far west of Scotland, and she taught an annual summer school of harp. She had a student who had a Dolmetsch harp, who was a young girl in about 1950. And this student learned left shoulder and fingernails and played the harp only at home for her own pleasure, right the way through, and this lady's still alive. Mm-hmm. I've seen her harp, and I'm going to try and visit her in the autumn and find out what she knows. So there was a secret underground tradition of playing metal strung medieval style. And so in about 1970, in the early 1970s, Anne read Bunting's book and understood what was going on and managed to get hold of an Otway-style harp made by Jay Witcher. This is her second Otway harp on the right, and then she's playing her first one on the left. And well, you will find out what happened after that, because Anne's going to do a chat with me later in the week, where we're going to talk about how she found the Irish harp, how she got into it, and her adventures since then. And I would say that almost all of the revival since then comes out of Anne's work. I started out by getting Anne's book, and then I met Anne. Siobhan started